Do it.
Check. Check.
Interpretively.
Exactly. Check, check. Need to plug in the monitors.
Good morning, everyone. Oh, no. Good morning, everyone. Oh. There we go. Peace be with you.
And also with you.
All right. I want to welcome everyone here. It is, again, extremely exciting, I think, and just to have everyone here. I know we're also live streaming. We just want to welcome you this morning. Again, those who are here and those that are watching via live stream Facebook, again, we are just excited to be able to come together to worship our Heavenly Father. He is so worthy of it. Amen? All right. Well, I tell you what, let's go ahead and pray, and we're going to go ahead and get our service kicked off. Dear Heavenly Father, once again, we are so grateful for the opportunity to gather together to worship you. And again, as we have all experienced, our rhythm of life has changed. Things are changing so quickly, but you know what? You, God, are so worthy of our worship. And yet, you provide ways and opportunities and new ways to gather together, whether it's here in our cars, whether it's, again, via technology. It's all for the purpose of worshiping you, honoring you, and glorifying you. And so, Father, as we gather here this morning, our prayer is once again that we would just pour out our hearts of gratitude, pour our hearts out of thanksgiving to you, Heavenly Father. Lord, we are going through some challenging times, but yet you are a good, 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 good Father. And we are so grateful for that. We're so grateful for you. And so we ask, Holy Spirit, that as we gather together here this morning, that you, Holy Spirit, would fill us, just that we would feel, just experience the manifested presence of you, Holy Spirit. And there's just something about being outside, and it's just a sense of your Spirit from the heavenlies pouring down upon us and going through, not just here, but going through, you know, the airwaves into homes, into people's hearts. We ask, Holy Spirit, that you would that we would encounter you in a radical, radical way, a way that we have never encountered you before. And Father, we know that, again, in challenging times, you are so close and you're so present. And so, Father, I just pray not only for us here, our body of Christ, but throughout the world, Lord, that people would encounter you, that they would know, that you are close and near. So come, Holy Spirit, come. Fill us with your presence. We surrender ourselves to you, Lord. We surrender ourselves to you, Holy Spirit, because we genuinely want to worship you here today. May you be honored and glorified in all our forms of worship, for you are so worthy of it. We pray it in the wonderful and glorious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens.
Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness.
Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and the lyre.
Praise him with the timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe.
Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Deep inside a current that moves and makes you come alive there.
painted blue in my own mind. Took me from dusty roads into paradise. All of my dirt, all of my shame, traveled streams that have made me born again. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes it come alive. Living water that brings a death to life. Oh, 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 we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Hey, hey, let's get washed by the water, washed by the water, rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river. Let's go down, down, down to the river.
Wash away my sin, nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. My pardon, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, no, no other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white and snow. Oh, no, no other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white and snow. Oh, no other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Yay!
Hallelujah!
step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether loving, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. The earth you created, all for love's sake you came. Here I am, so here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Here I am, so here I am to worship. Here I am to bow. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
One more time.
Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down.
To bow down before you, Lord.
You're my God. You're
alone,
all
worthy, Lord.
Altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
You alone, a worthy, Lord.
Here we are to worship. Here we are to bow down. Here we are to say that you're our God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Well, I just want to give you guys just a few quick announcements. If you need to use the restrooms, over here, Peggy, you honk the horn. Blue car over there. If you need to use the restrooms, go in that way. And the way the offering is going to work this morning, as you're leaving, if you were with us last week, it's going to be the same thing. As you're leaving, there will be these enormous orange tubs that say offering. You cannot miss them. And so if you want to give, you can just drop that in on the way out. So let's go to Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the space that you provided, Lord, this morning. for us to meet together. Lord, it looks just a little bit different, Lord, but we are together. And Lord, our purpose has not changed. Our purpose this morning is to grow closer to one another and to grow closer to you. And so, Lord, we pray for those things this morning. Lord, as our service transitions into the preaching of your word, Lord, I just pray that you would be with Pastor Jim as he preaches the word. Lord, I pray that we would, for these next 20 or 25 minutes, Lord, I just pray that all the different distractions that each one of us have going on in our lives, Lord, I pray that the distractions would be limited. That way we could just focus in on what you're trying to say to us through the word. And so, Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the people who are here this morning. Pray that you would bless them, bless their families. And Lord, we just give this time over to you, Lord. As the worship band just sang, Lord, we are here to worship you. And then so, Lord, we want to do that now through the preaching of your word. So, God, we pray that you would bless the service, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah, good morning, good morning. Y'all out there still? Still awake? Okay, all right. Just checking. Hey, you know, now I know you can make noise, right, during the sermon, so because you're honking the horns. So when we get back into the sanctuary, I want to hear a little more feedback coming from you on Sunday mornings. How about that? Is that all right? Sound like a good plan? It's okay to make noise in church. It's all right. Okay. All right, well, it's good to be here today, and I just want to give a special shout-out to Dee Dee Horn. Dee Dee is, as you many of you know, fighting a battle against what is commonly known as Lou Gehrig's disease. She is at home, and we have been praying for her, and we think that she is watching us right now live. She watched us last Sunday, and so if you've been praying for her, would you just let her know by honking your horn? All right, Dee Dee, we love you, and we hope that you are with us this morning live. We know you'll be watching it later if you're not with us live, but we are praying for you. We love you, and we miss you. So once these restrictions are lifted, we hope to be able to see you again here soon. So, all right, well, we had a little bit of trouble with our FM frequency for some reason. It is 100.1. Last Sunday, it got staticky during the service. It's been in and out today. We're not sure why. If it's staticky for a while, it'll probably clear up later. So anyway, just keep trying it, and we'll see how all of that works out today. So it was fun to gather last Sunday on Resurrection Sunday to worship our Lord, our risen Lord. And the message last Sunday was killing death. Sunday before that, Palm Sunday, we talked about facing death. Jesus rode into Jerusalem to face death. He rode into that city with the intent of killing death, and he defeated death on the cross and his resurrection on Easter Sunday, and he's returning to destroy death altogether. We talked about that last Sunday, to actually put a final end to death. 1 Corinthians 15:26 reminds us the last enemy to be destroyed is death. So I want to read today from John 20. This is the end of John's gospel. There is an epilogue. Chapter 21, but the whole gospel has been building to this point, chapter 20, in the Gospel of John. So we're going to read the entire chapter here this morning, and the title for this morning is That Sunday, which is Easter Sunday, what we now call Easter Sunday, and the Sunday after. So let's start with 20, verse 1. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Peter then came out with the other disciple, and they went toward the tomb. They both ran, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying and the napkin, which had been on his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who reached the tomb first also went in and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not know the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Saying this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom do you seek?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and said to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being shut where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the print of the nails, and place my finger in the mark of the nails, and place my hand in his side, I will not believe." 8 days later, and by Jewish reckoning, that would have been the next Sunday. They counted the day they were in as day one. So 8 days later would have been the next Sunday. 8 days later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. The doors were shut, but Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not be faithless, but believing." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Father, we thank you for your word, and we ask the Holy Spirit to enlighten us as we listen to it and as we receive what you have for us in it. You know, it's been amazing to watch as the world has been reacting out of fear of this COVID-19. The whole world has been disrupted in so many ways. Jesus rode into Jerusalem on that day we call Palm Sunday, knowing death was waiting for him there. He faced death head on because he came to kill death. The first step was accomplished at the cross and at the resurrection. He defeated death. But Jesus will return to destroy death altogether. In 1 Corinthians 15:45, which we looked at last Sunday, we read about the first Adam and the last Adam. The first Adam, the first of the human race, which ultimately fell. That first Adam rebelled against God, sinned against God, broke fellowship with God, and sin entered the world, and with it came death. It would take another human being, but a human being without sin, to fix what that first Adam had done. And so Paul, the Apostle Paul, refers to Jesus as the last Adam. Jesus is the first of a new race of humanity, a redeemed humanity. So he is the last Adam. He was able to correct what the first Adam had destroyed. We saw last Sunday in Revelation 20:11-15, that Jesus will be returning to kill death by throwing death and the realm of the dead, known as Hades in our scriptures, into the lake of fire, which is the second death. This is permanent death, eternal separation from God, the source of life. Now, there are some who teach that there is a thing called annihilation, that when you die and you're not in Christ, you're just simply annihilated. You cease to exist. That's not what the scriptures teach at all. The scriptures teach that you continue to exist just as you were dead spiritually before you received that second birth, the birth into life. You will be spiritually dead, but you'll be spiritually dead forever, separated from the life that is in God our Father. So it will be a permanent separation from the source of life. What a terrible existence that would be, especially knowing at that point absolutely that Jesus Christ is Lord. You will know that. There'll be no doubt anymore. Even if you denied him in life, you will know it then. And there will be no opportunity to repent at that point and come into his presence. So what a terrible thing that will be. So what we're talking about with eternity is not just that some go into eternity for eternal life and some go into annihilation. What we're talking about with eternity is eternity exists for those who go to life and for those who go to death. Both go into eternity. Am I still on out there? Can you hear me out there? Okay. All right. We lost it up here. Okay. So what we call Easter now changed everything. Literally changed everything. It redirected the trajectory of the human race. And it's completely appropriate that people all over the world, even if they do not acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, mark time. They may do so reluctantly, but they mark time based upon the entrance of Jesus into time. We break time down into before Christ and Anno Domini, which is the year of our Lord. Many years ago, because not everybody's Christian in the world, they try to rename that, and they called it BCE and ACE, before the Common Era and after the Common Era. The point is, it still refers to when Jesus came into the world, right? So time is marked by this man, our God who entered our world, became flesh, became that man, that last Adam who changed everything on Easter Sunday. And you know, everything didn't change just because of an empty tomb. It changed because of a living Jesus who was seen and encountered by those who had known him. You know, it's interesting that when the Apostle Paul shares those things that he first received as of first importance, we looked at this passage last Sunday, 1 Corinthians 15, he doesn't mention an empty tomb at all. Did you notice that when you read that chapter, 1 Corinthians 15, it talks about Jesus was crucified, died according to the scriptures. All this was to fulfill the scriptures. He was raised from the dead. He appeared first. He appeared then. He appeared next. It's all about the appearance of a living being to human beings. No mention of an empty tomb. Of course, even early on, there was an attempt to explain away the empty tomb. Well, his disciples came and stole his body away. And that was a lie that's been told to this day, according to the scripture, and it's still being told even today. So you could say, well, there's an explanation for the tomb being empty, you know, something like that. Doesn't make any sense for people who try to lie about it anyway. But the point is, Jesus was encountered as a living human being because he's been resurrected from the dead. We know that he's alive because people saw him. People who knew him saw him, just like Thomas here in our scripture today. The empty tomb is secondary. The empty tomb is empty because Jesus is alive. That's the point. Hebrews 2, 14 through 15 tells us the eternal Christ shared in our humanity, that through death he might destroy him who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong bondage. You know, it's our fear of death that gives the devil power over us, because fear always leads to bondage. Fear always leads to bondage. We'll do anything we need to do to avoid death if we walk in fear of death. And the devil always uses fear against us. And those with devilish agendas do exactly the same thing. One of our major political parties today has fully embraced a culture of death and ungodliness. These politicians insist the churches must remain closed. but the abortion centers must be fully open for business. Isn't it interesting that they call it being pro-choice, that a woman has the right to choose? But the governor of Virginia, Governor Ralph Northam, specifically mandated that there will be no elective surgeries, no elective medical procedures performed during this time, during the COVID virus. But then he exempted specifically abortion procedures. I thought they were called pro-choice. If I choose, I elect to do something, don't I? So why the exception for abortion? There are people who are wed to abortion. It's almost like they worship it as a god. And this is a perversion of God's design for life. And yet we see it so plainly today. These same politicians are trying to use this present crisis of fear to their advantage to try to steal away our freedoms as Americans. I mentioned last Sunday, Patrick Henry in his immortal words, "Give me liberty or give me death." I forgot to mention that he uttered those words in a church in Richmond, Virginia. I mentioned it was in Richmond. I forgot to say it was inside a church. You can still visit that church today up on Church Hill in Richmond, Virginia. And you can see where Patrick Henry said those words. And we need to live the same way. Live free or die was one of the mottos during the Revolutionary War. We need to live free as believers in Christ. Does anybody want to be in bondage? I don't. So we live free in Christ because he is the source of our freedom, because he defeated death. We don't need to live in fear of death anymore. There are worse things than death. Worse things than death. Satan's agenda is all about slavery, about bondage. The church's agenda, because it is the agenda of Christ, is all about freedom and life. You know, today the church is accused of being narrow-minded. We're bigots. We're haters, right? We're the bad people. We're the ones who subjugate women. On and on and on the list goes, because it's being uttered by those who have the spirit of Antichrist, lying spirits. The church has always been the leader in human freedom. That is the truth. That is the truth. But those who have rewritten our history, the history of America, have tried to hide that truth from the masses in the United States. We are the beacon of freedom in the world. The church, the people of God. Not the church that goes through religious rituals on a Sunday morning, but it doesn't mean anything, but the true living church that is redeemed by the blood of Christ. We are those who specialize in freedom and stand for freedom, and it always has been that way. The church is the one that has liberated women. The church is the one that has brought liberation to the masses. The church, the people of God in Christ, are the ones who have brought freedom to the world. It has always been that way. It will always be that way. And it's because we no longer live in fear of death. We're no longer in bondage to the god, small g, of this world. Well, that Sunday, Easter Sunday, what we now call Easter Sunday, changed everything. Now I want to talk about the Sunday after. See, Thomas was not present that Sunday for whatever reason. That evening of that day, he wasn't there when Jesus appeared in the community of faith. We don't know why he wasn't there. Doesn't tell us. It's not really important why he wasn't there. But we do know that he missed the blessing of encountering the living Lord because he wasn't there. He wasn't gathered with the community of faith. And when he was told about it, when he came back and they said, "Hey, we've seen the Lord," he reacts very defensively. This is just kind of human nature, isn't it? He actually becomes defiant because he missed out. "Well, I'm not going to believe that. I won't believe it until I see it myself. You know, I've got to be able to touch the wounds. I don't believe it." He was defiant in his response to what they said because they had experienced something special. And so often people react that same way when we share Christ with them. They're very, very defiant about it because they haven't experienced it themselves. And so they're missing out on something. They don't want to admit they missed out on something. So they get very defensive about it when we share the gospel. So we need to share the gospel in love, always, gently and in love, because we want them to experience those things. It's not a one-upmanship, you know, that we're in Christ and you're not. It's, "I know someone who can set you free. Let me share that person with you." We need to share gently with these people who don't know him. So Thomas wasn't there that Sunday after. The next Sunday, Jesus appeared again. And this is where the pattern of most Christians worshiping on Sunday comes from. Because it wasn't on the Sabbath day. The Sabbath day was Saturday. The Jewish Sabbath was Saturday. He was raised from the dead the next day, which was Sunday, the first day of the week. And the Christians gathered on Sunday. Jesus appeared to them that evening. He raised from the dead on Sunday. He gathered with them, with the disciples on Sunday. He appeared the next Sunday again in their midst. And so the Christian community began to worship on Sundays. It was the day that Jesus had risen from the dead. So each week they would specialize, they would focus in on the resurrection of Christ, the living Lord. They would gather to worship the living Lord. We set aside one Sunday a year. We call it Easter Sunday. Easter comes from a word meaning spring, originally. So we set it aside. We say, we're going to celebrate the resurrection of Christ this Sunday, once a year. Well, we should be celebrating the resurrection of Jesus every Sunday of the year and every other day of the year, right? Amen. So this is why we worship and meet together on Sundays. Most believers do that, not all. But that's where that pattern came from. And so the climax of the Gospel of John is here in chapter 20. This is where the whole gospel has been leading, in the words of Thomas, my Lord and my God. This is what John has been driving at the entire gospel. This is why you have all the I am statements of Jesus throughout the gospel. I am the bread of life. I am the water of life. I am the light of the world, and so forth. And then the ultimate I am statement in John 8:58, where he says, before Abraham was, I am. Clearly a claim to be God himself. They understood that. They wanted to stone him to death for blasphemy as soon as he said it. Because God had revealed himself initially, as you recall, as I am in the book of Exodus. That was his personal name. So when Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am, it was unmistakably a declaration that I am God. This is the point of John's gospel. John was the one who was most intimately acquainted with Jesus, the closest to him. And John wrote his account to emphasize, this is who Jesus is. He actually is God. He is God who came in the flesh. God became flesh. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. This is the point of the entire gospel. It's been driving to this point throughout the gospel, this statement of Thomas. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. John 20, verse 28. You know, you can't put everything in a book, one book about Jesus, right? And so John says, there are many other things written. He says, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. John and his community, those around him who ultimately put this together as disciples of John, they were focused like a laser focus on this point that Jesus is God. This is their point. These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Being called the Son of God is the same as being called God. That's why the Pharisees were upset when Jesus claimed sonship with the Father, because they understood what he was saying. You know, Jesus is incredibly patient with us. He's incredibly patient with unbelief as long as our hearts are open. He doesn't rebuke Thomas. He doesn't say, Thomas, you worthless so-and-so. Don't you believe? What's the matter with you? What's he say to him? Put your finger here, see my hands. Put out your hand, place it in my side. He invites him to touch him. He understands he's doubting. He understands he's questioning. And he says, look, touch me. Jesus wants you to know who he is. Jesus doesn't ever chastise us and push us away and call us fools or idiots for not believing or having doubts. He invites us. He says, come, touch. Touch me and see. See for yourself who I really am. We have such an incredible Lord. He's always patient as long as our hearts are open to him, as the heart of Thomas was. Jesus' response before he saw the risen Lord is understandable and so common. Even when many others have provided testimony that they know the Lord. Again, people tend to react defensively. Well, I don't know him, but they've never encountered him. And that's understandable. I've shared with people in the past. I understand you don't believe because you've never experienced him yourself. But he wants to meet you. He wants you to experience him. Trust him. Ask him to reveal himself to you, and he will do that. Jesus states that those who believe, those who can trust the testimony of others without seeing, are blessed. He says to Thomas, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. So what makes someone else's testimony believable? What makes somebody's testimony believable? Unfortunately, in our English Bibles, some of what Jesus is saying here has been obscured because in English, we have two different words being used here. We have faith and belief, and these seem like two different concepts, faith and belief. But in the Greek language, the language of the New Testament, they are forms of the very same word. To believe or to trust is to have faith. To have trust is to believe or to have faith. They are different forms of exactly the same word. If you could say it this way, I have faith in you. You could say, I believe in you. Two different, very different sounding words, but it's the same concept. In Greek, same form, different forms of the same word, faith and belief. You don't say to somebody, well, faith in Jesus. You say, believe in Jesus. You don't say faith in Jesus. So it's not as clear to us today in our English language, and that's a real shame here. So Jesus is saying that you're blessed because you've believed, because you've seen me, but blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. They believe because of the testimony of other people. So what makes it possible to believe somebody else's testimony? Well, a changed life is what makes it possible. You see the evidence before your eyes that person really does know the risen Jesus. You see a difference in that person's life. You want what they have. What they have is winsome. It's appealing to you. You see life itself in that individual because the Holy Spirit lives there, and you want that. You are willing to reach out for that and to trust that testimony because somebody clearly knows the risen Lord. That's why people are repelled by people who are judgmental. That's why people are repelled by holier-than-thou personalities, right? Who wants that? Nobody wants that. Nobody wants to put their faith in the Lord of somebody who's very judgmental and ugly. But they do want to know the Lord of somebody who's very gentle and winsome and kind and obviously has a source of life within them. So a changed life makes testimony believable. Now, the Sunday after Easter, how do we live? The Sunday after Easter. Do we make an effort to be in church on Easter, but the Sunday after finds us absent? You know, this is a very common thing, actually. Little inside secret is pastors call the Sunday after Easter Low Sunday. Low Sunday. Because ironically, it's typically the lowest attended Sunday of the year. It's the Sunday after Easter. And of course, Sunday is the highest attended Sunday of the year. So from one week to the next, you see this flip-flop of people being in church on Sunday. Now, being in church doesn't save you by any stretch of the imagination, but the point is a very simple point. How do you live on the Sundays other than Easter Sunday? How do you live on the days other than Easter Sunday? If we honor Christ on Easter Sunday but don't honor him the other days of the week, we're giving a lie to what we said on Easter Sunday. So do we live as if Christ is alive? Do we live as if we serve him every single day of our lives? Do we live as if he has changed everything, that he has changed us? If we know the risen Jesus, we cannot be indifferent to who he is. Because believing is more than intellectual assent. You see, we have, in our Western culture, we have made believing synonymous with, well, I agree with that concept. I believe that. I agree with that concept. But I just talked about in Greek and in thinking of Jesus, to believe was to have faith. See, we say, no, I can believe something. That doesn't mean I have faith. We've separated the two, and they're not supposed to be separated at all. They're actually the same thing. So believing is more than intellectual assent. John 20, 31 says, but these things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. It's not agreement with an intellectual concept that gives you life. It's having faith, having trust in Jesus himself that gives you life. When you believe, you have faith. And that's the point here. It's about relationship with Christ. Salvation doesn't come by agreeing with a concept. Salvation comes in relationship with the one who is the resurrection and the life. One of the I am statements of Christ himself, his claim to be God, is I am the resurrection and the life. That is the one we serve. He is the one we honor today, the Sunday after Easter and every other day of the year. Let's pray. Father, we honor you today. We thank you for your Son. Lord Jesus, we honor you as the living Lord, the resurrected Savior, the one who has ascended to the right hand of God the Father in heaven, who's interceding for us even now. At his right hand, the one who is preparing to return. And at your return, Lord, we know that you will indeed kill death. That death will be no more. Neither will there be crying, nor mourning, nor pain anymore, because all the former things will have passed away. So, Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you that the struggles of this life are momentary. They can seem overwhelming. They can seem like such a burden to us in the flesh. But we recognize in the light of eternity that these things are temporary. They are preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. Because the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Lord, we thank you that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven, but that we all will be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet. The dead in Christ will rise first, but then those who are alive, who are left, shall be lifted up to meet him in the air. And so we shall all be with the Lord. Father, we thank you for your grace, for your love, for your mercy. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Son. Lord, help us to live as people who believe, people who have faith, people whose witness each and every day is consistent with faith. We pray that you would multiply the evidence of our faith, that people would be able to see the living Christ in us by his Spirit each and every day. Lord, we want to honor you in our community. We want to honor you in our world. We continue to pray for that great awakening and revival we so desperately need. We thank you for today, Lord, for this beautiful, glorious day to come outside in the sunshine and worship you. We pray for a mighty revival in our area, that you would fill this place, Lord, with your glory and your presence. Lord, I speak forth blessing and covering over each person who is here today, each family represented. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, I proclaim a blessing of peace by the authority of the crucified one who was dead, yet is alive forevermore. In the name of Jesus Christ, go forth in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. Amen. So the worship team is going to come back up. They're going to lead us in worship as we're exiting the parking lot. And you've already heard about instructions about the offering if you'd like to give. Please don't feel compelled to do that, but if you'd like to do that, if you want an envelope, we do have envelopes as well today. So go in peace, love and serve the Lord. God bless you. It's so good to see you here today. Weather permitting, we'll be out here until the COVID-19 restrictions are lifted. If there's any hint of rain, we're not going to be able to set up all this electronic equipment outside. And what we'll have to do is go back indoors. We'll have to just live stream a closed worship service out. I hope you'll join us there by live stream if we have to do that. So God bless you and go in peace.
Praise the Lord. All right. Can we get one more beep? I know a place where we can go to lay the troubles down, eating your soul. I know a place where mercy flows, take the stains, make them whiter than snow. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Oh, we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Hey, 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 let's get washed by the water, rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river. Let's go down, down, down to the river. I've seen it bloom in my own life. Took me from dusty roads into paradise. All of my dirt, all of my shame, drowning streams that have made me born again. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Oh, we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Hey, let's get washed by the water, washed by the water. Rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river. Let's go down, down, down to the river. Oh, 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 let's go down. Oh, 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 let's go down. We're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to pray. Hey, hey, washed by the water, washed by the water, rise up in amazing grace. Let's go down, down, down to the river. 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 Let's go down. Beep.